better roll them dice. You never know if it could change your life. Take a chance, you're neither wrong or right. You never know if you don't roll them dice. You better roll them dice. You never know if it could change your life.
Rob, slather on your SPF 5000 because we're going to be bathing today, sunbathing, star bathing in the light of Xaryxis. Solar bathing.
Absorbing the powerful rays of a dying sun, as all suns are, because all suns are dying. We're all dying. The end is coming. Life is just one march towards the end. The great dissipating heat death of the universe is coming. But if you live in Xaryxis, it's coming much sooner, and you got to do something about it. But yeah.
Yeah, that's right. You know, if your sun is dying, if your planet is dying, you should always, step one, invent a Death Star. Step two, make the Death Star useful, actually. This points a lot of things out. Like, the Empire is just blowing up entire planets. You know, this seems like a more efficient, like, if you're going to basically wipe out a planet, maybe you should find some way to, I don't know, preserve its precious natural resources.
Right? Yeah. There's a lot of heavy metals, a lot of rare resources, you know, in a planet. Listen, 98% of the matter in the universe is hydrogen or something like that. So, you know, every precious little bit of solid planet is valuable. You can't just go around nuking that with your Death Star beam. The Empire was always very impractical, you know?
I do like, maybe they weren't, if you take the, like, the Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy view of the universe. Okay, like, the universe is infinite, so, like, almost basically anything that exists. Like, I remember there's, like, the throw-off joke of, like, yeah, we don't have mattress factories anymore. We don't make mattresses, because there's obviously a planet where mattresses just grow on the ground. You just harvest them. And that's true for basically everything. So, yeah. Actually, that's a great idea for your Dungeons & Dragons Spelljammer campaigns. Just say the universe is so massive that whatever you need, you can go to
you just have to, yeah, you should go and find it.
Hey, we're reviewing Light of Xaryxis, and we're focusing on how to rework the campaign, at least for Rob and I's playstyle. It's Dungeon Master of None.
I'm Dungeon Master Rob.
I'm Dungeon Master Matt. And this is a, 65-page adventure that's included in the Spelljammer box set. It starts at 5th level, ends at 8th, as Rob and I talked about on our last episode, inspired by serialized sci-fi of the 30s, 40s, 50s, and their remakes, aiming for lots of camp and crazy encounters.
Yeah, it's your Flash Gordon early Battlestar Galactica. Especially, and they've mentioned this also, the 1980 remake scored by Queen. Awesome movie, you should check it out. It's a good time. But the issue, I suppose, is that as we alluded to, this doesn't quite hit the mark. It has some major structural problems, and the promise, the very cool promise of what we were told we were getting is just really not fulfilled. You're not gonna feel like Buck Rogers. You're not gonna feel like Flash Gordon. You're gonna feel like you're strapped into a roller coaster ride that kind of moves sort of slowly and confusingly.
Yeah, it's a theme park ride with many detours. I guess we should say, like, why does that not work? It could work for some people, I'm sure. But if your players have to be very, very passive for this type of campaign to work. I think one of the great things, the only reason I really like Spelljammer is because it is a point crawl or a hex crawl of the universe,
right,
with your players in the command seat. And you can give them quests. You can have them decide on quests. But they have a ton of freedom.
Yeah.
And this is not a campaign that really embraces that idea. Because it's maybe a little harder to write, I think.
Well, and so there's two problems here. Like, one is exactly what Matt pointed out. I don't know that Spelljammer, where you, again, I just cannot understand why you would play Spelljammer and not give your players a ship. That's the most exciting part about Spelljammer. So one, it doesn't make much sense to give your players a spacefaring vessel and then put their campaign on rails. And two, there's nothing wrong with a railroady adventure. We've discussed it at length. I think that it can be very fun. Some of the best adventure paths written both by Wizards and by Paizo are pretty linear.
Third parties,
you know, they can be very linear, but there's a right way and there's a wrong way to do it. And you can, this adventure does not really make your players feel like they are choosing to follow the path. It does not give them a good reason. It just kind of drags them along. And so there's two problems. One, it's a poorly written linear adventure path. And two, it's the wrong setting for it. So a lot of things, in my opinion, need to be changed to make this work. But
There's a lot to like here.
There's a lot to like. There's a lot of good ideas, and I can see, again, I can immediately see how I run it differently, but as written, it really does not work, and I don't think your players are going to enjoy it very much. I don't think you're going to enjoy running it very much.
Here's Rob and I's, I think, fundamental critique, is that you need to change basically the fundamental structure of the entire middle of the plot. And to talk about how we would do that, I think we first need to go through the details of what we have, and then we can kind of return to, at the end of the episode, how we would, rework most of the adventure, or rearrange it, or save most of the parts of it and present them in a different way.
Yeah. So I think that makes the most sense.
So to that end, let's go to our quick rundown of this adventure. So it's presented in four parts of three chapters each. So you get 12 chapters that are meant to be a single play session each. And I like this like idea. Okay, like, hey, we've really broken it down for you. This is where you need to get to at the end of every play session. Every play session kind of ends on kind of a joke or real cliffhanger. That, yeah, I kind of like you end every play session in a cliffhanger. Yeah,
that I did like. I don't think that it works as written, but this is a new structure, and again, it's designed to mirror the episodic structure. You have Buck Rogers or Flash Gordon ending on a high note, a cliffhanger. Something is attacking. Something exciting has happened. A big twist. But
At the actual table. Like, let's say you're playing a 12 session campaign.
Yeah.
One of the problems is not all those sessions are going to be the same length. Sometimes people are going to have to leave early. Sometimes you find something really interesting that your players want to do, and you definitely don't want to hurry them along. So if you don't want to be beholden to this cliffhanger structure, and feel free to like readjust when they happen, or it's okay if not every session ends on a cliffhanger, right? Or you could always just, you know, adjust your cliffhanger. Oh, the cliffhanger this time is just, we're about to start a combat that you guys were about to do. Or cliffhanger, you just enter a new wild space system. Wonderful, right? Okay. Don't feel like you have to follow this actual chapter session. So that's the structure of the adventure. Shall we talk about, I guess, chapter one, how the adventure starts?
Yeah, let's just do it. So for background, this is relevant because it's going to come up immediately. There is a astral empire called Xaryxis, the Xaryxian Empire. From Xaryx space, and their sun is dying, and they're a big astral elf empire, and they send their ships around to basically drain other planets of life energy to feed their star. Right. We'll go into greater detail, but that's the core.
Right. They're Death Starring other worlds to keep their system alive. The Astral Elves are, you know, mostly live on the astral plane, except these ones don't. Why these elves don't just move to the astral plane where they're immortal, or move their base to the astral plane, which apparently they have the power to do, doesn't quite make sense to me. But then again, I'm not an astral elf. So.
I suppose, so they don't need this star to survive. I suppose that it would make sense if I were writing this, if I were trying to rewrite this, I would say that they have some sort of religious or cultural attachment to their...
Right, this is their original homeworld.
Yes. And so their gods or their faith demands that they keep their star alive. That makes sense. But that, as it is, it's just kind of like they're doing it to keep their star alive because they need to, but they don't need to. They don't need to at all. They can, as Matt has pointed out, they can just move into the astral plane or a different realm space or something. I don't know. It doesn't, right. This is
the material plane is infinite. You could find another place to live.
This is maybe the step one you need to fix to make this make sense, but it's just the beginning.
The background beyond that, like, you know, obvious misstep in logic is very cool. And of course, the aesthetic of the astral elves are really cool. They look very like cool space versions of the cool elves from Hellboy 2, Golden
that's
Army.
Right.
And in fact, they're ruled by a like, or about to be ruled by competing siblings, just like the creepy elf twins in Hellboy 2, the Golden
Army.
Listen, if you're going to steal elf twins from a movie, then, I mean, you can't find any better.
Aesthetically, they go around in star moths, which are, and this is, again, this is all art direction, but I really like this. All of the astral elf stuff is a combination of sort of weird celestial stuff, but also naturally inspired. So their moths look a little organic and, you know, but they're, it's really good art design. It looks really cool. And again, their masks are cool. And the thing that they use to drain planets are big astral blights, astral vines. So they send down crystal seeds and then they spring up big, towering, thorny stalks and spawn blights. And this is pretty cool. I like this. I like this combo of space and nature twisted into a weird way.
Right. And like in Guardians of the Galaxy 2, the one with Kurt Russell, that is basically right. They use that to destroy planets.
Yep.
And so the players start at fifth level. There's an intro adventure that's free on D&D Beyond called Spelljammer Academy, which I read, I wasn't like a super fan of because it's not my style. Like, players are kind of, again, led around by the nose being taught how to be Spelljammer crew. It gets a little bit better in the later adventures. This will take them up to fifth level, but it also sort of gives you the background of there's a entire like fleet of Spelljammers on the homeworld the players start out on, which would make players kind of question the logic that the adventure begins with, which is that basically the astral elves nuke their homeworld with these crystal vines. They begin sucking the energy out, and the players are space lifted out of there by a friendly Spelljammer captain that just happens to be in the tavern they're in. And of course, if they have a link to a Spelljammer Academy, like, my players would be just, why don't we go back to the base that has like seven Spelljammers and all of our friends who know lots of stuff, and they can help us out.
Well, and Matt, you're trying to make sense of this, but the adventure explicitly doesn't, I think, suggest that you use that Spelljammer Academy, because it seems to assume that you're, and this is one approach, but I don't like it, but it seems to assume that your players are ordinary, ground-dwelling fantasy characters who are suddenly swept into a grand spell-jamming adventure, like, you know, Last Starfighter or something. You know,
or like the first module that was released with the Spelljammer box set in the 1980s or 90s, Wild Space, which I actually ran you through. So
yeah. And this is one approach, but Matt, you made this point last week, and I agree with it. If you're going to play a Spelljammer campaign, maybe you want your players to be Gif or Hadazi or Plasmoids or whatever. You don't, you know, it can be fun to have an a party of, you know, dwarves and elves and gnomes and whatever if they want to do that. But if you're pitching a Spelljammer campaign to your players, don't you think they might want to be spelljamming races? So I think the first thing that I would do, I mean, the first problem, right, is that I think that the starting, so I guess, sorry, let's talk about how the chapter one works, because it's pretty really like straightforward.
Pretty basic, yeah.
Is they're in a coastal village somewhere, and there's a reason for this, and a bunch of astral shards rain down, and all these blights and things start springing up. They have to save some people, run away. They run into this captain, Elena Sartell, who has a galleon, and
who says, basically, come with me if you want to live.
Come with me if you want to live, which is fine. That's okay. That's cool. But, you know, it, again, this is a little tricky. It assumes they end up on her galleon, which takes off into the skies because it's actually a spelljammer.
There's a fun encounter with, like, a local crime boss who's like, we got to evacuate this town. It's about to be destroyed. Actually, I get all the seats, and the players have a chance to negotiate or kill that person and
which is pretty
maybe
fun.
Evacuate yeah. some of the townsfolk, which that's fine.
So this is cool. This is fine. This is chapter one. But if your players are fine with, you know, we just spent 5 levels playing Waterdeep Dragon Heist or Lost Minds of Phandelver or whatever, and we want to get wacky with it, then this works perfectly. But that's kind of the only circumstance in which this works perfectly. And I think that the broader adventure is much, much better suited for a crew of wild space spell jamming characters, people who are familiar with and, you know, built for, designed with all of that in mind.
So let's rework this. Assuming, let's say, you've been playing a campaign from level one as Spelljammers, or assuming that you just want to start playing Spelljammer and you just want everyone to roll up a level 5 character, I would say that they're on a planet that they are going on a mission on, right? If you want to, in kind of Flash Gordon Star Wars fashion, start in media res, you tell the players, all right, you're doing a like smuggling deal, or you're doing some kind of like trade negotiation for magic weapons or something. You're meeting this crime boss in a tavern or something like that. And then that's when on a planet, and that's when that planet gets attacked. And of course, the players can fight their way out and escape. Everyone on the ground has no idea, but your players are like, okay, these came from space. We can investigate what's going on. And you could, if you wanted to really mix things up, one of the shards lands and it destroys the player's ships. So they have to hitch a ride with Sartell, and they're like, all right, well, you tell your players you're going to get a ship, as you know, fairly soon in this adventure. So I would switch that up and, okay, yes, the players' homeworld isn't under attack, though you could make it the homeworld of one of your players. But the players should want to kind of like, oh man, well, someone's destroying whole planets. Maybe the deal that they had with this planet was really good. Like, there's lots of cool things here. So it writes yourself a little like in the middle of the action adventure where the players are doing a spell jamming adventure on this planet when it's attacked.
Yeah, I agree with this. Have them be on a planet. They're doing a job, much like how you would start many of your D&D adventures. Just assume that the players already have some connection and they're working together. Ask them in session zero how they know each other and what they're doing. They're level 5, right? And then they're attacked. Now, that, like Matt mentioned, the easy thing about the adventure as written is their homeworld's under attack. Got to do something about that, or it's going to get turned into space goop. And there's really no way to say no to Elena Sartell because the town's being destroyed. But yes, it's a little bit more complicated. Yes, you may have to do a little bit more legwork as a DM, but I think it's going to be more satisfying to give them, instead of, you know, forcing them into a dramatic situation, to present a galaxy-threatening enemy and then give them an opportunity to deal with it.
Here's one more hook that might be a little less work, is if you're doing a strong session zero. Another suggestion I sort of came up with was, okay, tell your players you were all the crew of a ship, and you as the dungeon master create a cool NPC captain. Maybe they're a pirate, maybe an evil smuggler, and your players, for one reason or another, were marooned here on this planet and have been there for like 6 months without a job, kicked off their spell jamming vessel for some crime or some betrayal, some mutiny. And if you want to do a collaborative session zero, maybe your players can figure out what their crime or mutiny was. Maybe they're all connected. Is the captain that they worked for before kind of an evil person? You could come up with it together. So like you're all, and that's the hook, you're all spell jammers without a ship, stuck on a groundling world where no one ever does it. And then that'll give you an NPC to introduce later on in the campaign that the players, of course, can get their revenge on. Maybe even the evil captain that the players committed some crime against knew that or had a hint that this world would one day be destroyed. So they left them there and knowing they would all die eventually. But through a twist of fate, hey, there's another spelljammer here that we can get off the planet with.
Yeah.
I like that. That's chapter one. Chapter two is kind of an introduction to dungeon crawling in space.
Yeah.
Players zoom out, and the person who saved them, Captain Elena Sartell, is like, I don't know what's going on here, but if I take you to a nearby spell jamming haven, the Rock of Brawl, you can find out what's going on. I'm happy to take you there. And the players encounter a derelict Mind Flayer dreadnoughts and are attacked by Neoji. Oh, sorry. As soon as the players break atmosphere, the astral elves attack.
Yes. So this, in my opinion, is really when the adventure starts to go off the rails, because two things happen right away. Like before the players can even catch their breath, they're attacked by a astral elf star moth, and they have to do a ship battle and fight it off. And I understand why this is presented. I think the adventure writers wanted to give an opportunity for space battle right away. I don't think this is great for reasons that I'll get into in a moment. Even beyond whether or not this encounter should go here, it assumes the players survive and win. But when they do, if they board the Star Moth, the Dark Star, there's a little bit that's here that's like, oh, the Hadozi say you shouldn't take this ship. And I'm just like, why wouldn't I take this ship?
Why wouldn't you take the ship? Yeah. So if the players win, obviously they've just captured a pretty decent ship. Yeah, Star Moths nice have ship. Great stats. The basically the crew of the ship, who are not elves, they're Hadozi, say, oh, yeah, the elves would really not like it if you took this ship. But the players have at this point just found out that's the elves that are destroying the world. So I'd be like,
they
who
already
the fuck
don't
cares.
Like, yeah, but they're already your enemy. This is a major, like, I don't like to talk about plot holes, but like this is a serious plot hole, adventure hole. I cannot imagine any group of players not taking this ship. If I was like putting on my most convincing DM hat and, you know, brought out a very charming, compelling Hadazi crewmate, they would ignore him. They'd be like, no, we're taking this ship. I don't care how dangerous it is. I don't care if we get shot at by every single Star Moth. This is cool. I want this ship.
It was dangerous, a smart player would say, well, yeah, sure, it's dangerous, but wouldn't having an elven ship maybe in a couple circumstances allow us to sneak past some elves or something?
Yes.
And how could you say no to that? Of course it would.
Yeah, right.
Players at fifth level have access to disguise self and alter self, and they can steal the costumes of the astral elves.
It worked in Master and Commander. It would work in Spelljammer. I don't know why you would
run up those crystal sails lubberly like as a whaler would, as an astral elf would. Yeah.
Yeah.
Captain, so it's a plasmid. Yeah, okay. So the players obviously at this point now have a Star Moth and they have their own ship.
Then the adventure is completely off the rails, which is fine. But then you have a different adventure. So this is problem one. Problem two, and this is what Matt was talking about, the second thing they encounter is a derelict Nautiloid.
Which, I don't know, I kind of like this. It's kind of a random encounter on the way to where they're going. It's a dungeon they can explore. You know, as written, it really assumes that they're going to want to explore this. They don't have to. There's nothing important to the plot here. However, it's a cool dungeon. This is actually one of my favorite dungeons. And what's great about Chapter 3 is that you could take this and plop it at basically any point in the adventure or into any Spelljammer campaign. It's just a derelict ship. The twist in the end is one of the survivors on the crew is on the ship is there to kill them. And also it's an ambush of Neo-Gi who are waiting in the asteroids nearby. This is great.
I like Chapter 3 as well. The Lucent Edict is a great dungeon, and there's this cool added complication of the person they find, the survivor, is trying to trick them, divide them, eat them. Very cool.
I would say...
Don't know that it goes here.
Yeah, just take this, treat Chapter 3, and we'll save this to when we get to our reworking at the end. And keep in mind, you can put it anywhere, right? It doesn't have anything to do with the plot. You can put it anywhere. As written, the players are ambushed when they leave the dungeon, and the local navy helps them out. You don't need to have this happen. The players then arrive in Chapter 4. We've moved on to Part 2 and the Rock of Brawl. And the Rock of Brawl, we have write-ups of for second edition in the new box set. We have a nice map of it. There's lots to explore here. The players aren't given a huge opportunity to explore the Rock of Brawl, and a couple of things don't make sense. As written, the Rock of Brawl is either orbiting the world that got attacked or is somewhere else in that world's wild space system. In either one of those cases, people at the Rock of Brawl would care if that world was getting destroyed, because it's obviously a huge source of resources, trade. Probably lots of people are from there on the Rock of Brawl. Why wouldn't they care? Especially if the Rock of Brawl is orbiting the world, orbiting a world full of millions of people versus orbiting a world that's a dead, lifeless husk. Prince Andrew and everyone else on the rock would care about this. But as it's written, Prince Andrew, one of his advisors, is a friend of the Xaryxian Empire. So there's a chance for some intrigue there, but it never really pays off. The players are ambushed by astral elves. They meet the local naval captain, Captain Crux, who is willing to ferry them to the next stage of the adventure. Commodore Crux. I would say, again, there's nothing fundamentally wrong here. It's just that the players aren't allowed to explore. Wouldn't it be much cooler if you went to your Rock of Brawl book and said, okay, players, you can spend as much time as you want here. Maybe you need to get a ship. How can we make that happen? You can make deals with a bunch of people to maybe lease a ship instead of you have to join Commodore Crux's ship.
Yeah. And this is just a real, real bummer to me, because Chapter 4 is, they get ambushed by these Neo-Gi. They're saved by the local Navy. They make it to the Rock of Brawl. They meet Crux. They meet another Spelljammer. What's her name? Fel, Ardra. And then they're immediately off. There's just no time. It does mention Large Luigi. We love Large Luigi, but there's no, it doesn't say they can't explore, but they're very much encouraged to hop on the next ship that will take them somewhere and go on to the next thing. And it's just very breakneck, and the Rock of Brawl is great.
Yeah. Here's how I would rework this one, is plan for a session or two at the Rock of Brawl, basically as long as the players want to stay there. You say, this is an interesting place. Here's the map of it. Do whatever you want. Your goal is to get a ship. You have to make a deal with someone unless you have enough money to buy your own. And then the players, might be like, all right, why don't we go to this Rock of Brawls in the same system as a planet that's about to be destroyed? Why don't we go to the authorities and they, get an audience with Prince Andrew or one of his lieutenants, and they find out Prince Andrew isn't as concerned as he logically should be, thereby hinting at a greater conspiracy that Andrew has cut some deal with the Xaryxian Empire, introducing a minor villain, Ruthless Rhaegar. Fine. However, obviously lots of other people, the Rock of Brawl, are concerned. People who have connections to the planet, some of the sub-factions, and maybe the players can cut a deal with one of those. And this can build future seeds. The players can come back to Rock of Brawl, help start a revolution or a power struggle against Andrew. Maybe they ally with the Jester's Men, or I forget some of the other factions. But yeah.
Again, we'll have to come back to this, but there's some factions at the end that are very important for ultimately defeating the Xaryxian Empire, but they only really show up in the last few chapters, and this would be a great place to
have one or two of them have a presence on Brawl, right?
This is a major mistake. So again, what I would do, again, reading the first few chapters, I would put everything from part one, except for the initial adventure, either I would remove it or put it after Rock of Brawl. I think the players should get to Rock of Brawl as soon as possible without a bunch of annoying random encounters in between.
Yeah.
So they can start meeting people, learning things. There's plenty to do. You can set up plenty of Flash Gordon type adventures and conflicts on the Rock of Brawl. But even though this is a spacefaring adventure, you got to spend some time in port in a fun Spelljammer-y, port is a great time, great place to spend time, you know?
Right. You make this as interesting as possible because one, the players can shop for ships. That can be adventures of themselves. Maybe they don't have the money. They have to do a quest for someone or make a deal. Every magic item the players might want to get could be obtained here for a price. There are all sorts of unique factions. There are people who have maps and cool ship items. And of course, yes, treat with Prince Andrew. And then when things get boring, you deploy the encounter of some astral elf assassins attack to remind the players now that the astral elves have marked them for extermination. And then you could even introduce the players to this kind of Rhaegar guy. I forget their name, Hastane. Earlier, and so when the players leave and are attacked by
another
giant jellyfish person,
another random encounter, they actually
it's
have
not
some,
so random. It's right, like,
it doesn't.
This
feel
was
random.
The guy who was whispering in Prince Andrew's ear and shut us down when we tried to convince him logically, you should care about the planet. This asteroid's orbiting, getting destroyed.
Right, right.
Okay, and then here's where the adventure really kind of becomes a fairly big problem. And the problem is this, is the players at this point should have a ship, either one that someone has given them or one that they've got on their own. They should be their own ship captain, ignore the stuff about them having to follow Commodore Crux around. And the plot at this point is basically go to a person, go to another person, go to another person, go to another person. And by the rules we're given for Wild Space, if the players just leave their system and go to the Astral Sea and they're like, take me to Xaryxis space, they should know how to go there.
Right.
So it's at this point you want to make this adventure not a linear fetch quest, because reading through it, and I know playing through it, it would become frustrating as the players are like, we need to accomplish something here. And instead, they go to a hermit bird wizard who then sends them to a vampirate who then just happens to have an important space princess who then sends them to another gif who then sends them to a mercane. And then they can like start to confront the elves. It's just
this is
too many fetch or find the next NPC quests.
And this is what I meant when I said, you know, theme park. It feels like the adventure writers wanted to make sure that you saw every cool thing that's in Spelljammer. Let's have an encounter with a Nautiloid. Let's have an encounter with a scaver called Big Mama. Let's have an encounter with a vampirate. Let's have some auto gnomes. But let's force the players to go and spend time with each of the new things that we created. And this is the wrong way to do that.
Yeah. Here's also where we miss the forest for the trees in that, I'm thinking of like, what are the crazy encounters that we have here? Okay. There's a derelict Nautiloid. There is a hermit that lives on a tower by herself floating in space with a bunch of birds. Like, that's cute. But, like, considering the things
I like the idea of a astral cartographer. It's just that, and this is a rule I would change, I don't know why this was ever in the book, but like, according to the fifth edition rules of Spelljammer, if you can just know where you're going and float in that direction. It's
yeah, you don't really need an astral cartographer. I guess she can give you a map of the system itself, so yeah, you don't have to wander around once you're in the system. But at the same time, that might be kind of fun. Here's the main thing, though, is like in Spelljammer, and they had this in Spelljammer Academy, like you should go to a world that's a giant disc of water built around a mountain. You should go to a world that's a weird donut. You should go to a world that's a ball of fire that in the inside is the planet. You should go to a world that's a floating cube. You should go to a world that is pulled, that sits on a giant's shoulder who trudges around the sun, and you can go talk to the giants. You know, you don't go to any of the really weird things, right? You should go to a world that's a living planet, right? Mm. You should go to a world where everyone's a vampire, you know, all this kind of stuff.
Yep.
So there's none of that level of weirdness. There is a system that orbits a black hole. That's fine. That's a start. But like, that is regular sci-fi weirdness, right? That's not Flash Gordon. That's not Spelljammer level weirdness, which should be very, very weird. Okay, yes. Let's talk. I don't know. We don't have to spend too much time talking about the fetch quest. You meet a cartographer. The cartographer is like, oh, I don't know who can help you. You have an encounter that like has to happen. And then the cartographer is like, now I know who can help you. And they send you to a pirate who is a vampire. And then you have to help that vampire deal with a ghost mutiny. That's actually, you know, kind of neat. But it's also like, again, the players are shuffled from one ship to another. They never have a chance to just kind of have their own ship. All of this works more or less the same if you let them have their own ship. The vampire has the princess of the Xaryxian Empire. And then finally, the plot can kind of continue. But
and this is when you remember, oh, right, this is a fun sci-fi pulp adventure because you've got a space princess. Oh, right, I'm Flash Gordon again. But you've just spent who knows how many sessions being jerked around on a fetch quest. And the sort of intent here is that you're putting together a crew. I love this. I love putting together a crew. I love assembling fun NPCs. You still want your PCs to be the center of attention. But, you know, these people, Commodore Crux, Grismod, Garganhale, even Topola, the bird wizard, are all pretty interesting, and they make great members of a crew. But it should be the player's ship, and they should be doing this for a reason, not just sort of randomly collecting them through random encounters or being told on a fetch quest to go meet somebody.
Yeah, here's the problem is you gotta, like, okay, I get the Flash Gordon. There's a Flash Gordon reveal of, like, the vampire's like, if you help me deal with my mutiny, I have a weapon that can be used against the Xaryxian Empire. This is where you can go back to your Rock of Brawl chapter and present the players with three options. Okay, one person they meet says they know a cartographer who has maps of the Xaryxian Empire's system and knows of a location where, and maybe that's all they have. You hear a rumor, unsubstantiated, that there's a vampire that lives in System X that was trying to sell a weapon that could be used against the Xaryxian Empire at the Rock of Brawl 2 months ago. There were no buyers. Prince Andrew shut him down and he left after being chased by the fleet. And then number three, the players have heard through a Mercane that there is many worlds have been destroyed by the Xaryxians. And there was talk of an alliance, and it's in a location called Doom Space. And so the players can investigate all three of those. They could even, after the Rock of Brawl, just head straight to the Xaryxian Empire space, at which the players are fucking routed by a giant fleet. And they learn, okay, we've got to get either some leverage over these elves, or we've got to assemble the Rebel Alliance. And that's fine. It lets the players discover that on their own. Of course, if the players have their own Starbath, they might be clever enough to be able to sneak into the... And that would be fine, too.
That would be
because
good.
Because they still lack the weapon that can destroy the thing, but they can muck around in the Imperial Citadel. Maybe they'll get captured. Maybe they'll escape by the skin of their teeth. That's fine. It'll let them come back to this and feel really good when they can eventually blow up the Death Star.
Right. So they have to go to Doom Space.
So Doom Space is where the supposed alliance is being assembled, but when they arrive, it's actually not the case.
And Doom Space is, it's not quite as cool as some of the systems that Matt mentioned, but it's pretty cool.
It's okay.
It's
we need to get here much sooner, right? Yes, and you need to have like three of these really cool systems.
Not one of the random encounters that we've had has been as cool as Doom Space, and we should get Doom Space right away, or right after Rock of Brawl.
Right. Yeah, that should be one of the three options the players can investigate, right? Is that, there's a Xaryxian refugees there, right? People's planet's been destroyed. Also, I love that there's a nice little nod to earlier editions in that Doom Space once had a crystal sphere that was shattered.
Yes. There was a war between the gods and the primordials. There's some cool planets, a lot of them inhabited by monsters. I wish there were more descriptions, but we got something. You know, this is the only other system aside from Xaryxis that we have any information about in the whole Spelljammer box set. So something, it's nice. You meet a sort of colonial Britain gif named Major Warwick Blastemoff, and he's on safari on a world full of Artooks and Tarasks and things like that, and you have to, more random encounters that you have to fight stuff off, but I like this guy and I like these encounters, but it just feels very like you've got to go to this place because somebody told you to go there, right?
Right. In this example, this great encounter, the players have to go down to an away team and land on a world where Tarasks are like cows. That's insane and cool. And fight some, save a friend from Artooks. That's great. But the problem is, it's just like randomly, without any foreshadowing, an NPC tells them, like, hey, my friend is down there.
Right.
And instead, like, you can put, like, just, hey, oh, yeah, there was someone who once fought the Xaryxian Empire. Their last known location was here. And the players can decide whether they want to do this or not.
And that's a very compelling hook. If you just say, there's a, you know, somebody who's got experience fighting the Xaryxian Empire, he'd be a great ally, help rally the Alliance. They may not bite, but that's also okay. But like, don't just have Crux say, we got to go to this planet and pick up my old buddy. Like,
right.
Give them
and
a
just
choice.
Think of how it fucks up the actual play of an encounter or an adventure at the table when the players go down with Commander Crux to find his old buddy, and they meet the old buddy. Obviously, logically, what happens is Crux and the old buddy start talking or say hello. And instead, if you take away Commander Crux, the players have to meet this person and discover, are they actually their ally, or are they, you know, kind of crazy, or, you know, it makes it more fun. It puts the players in the helmsman's chair.
So our next chapter,
the Arena of Blood.
Like the idea, I'm just not sure about the execution, but the players meet, or they're told that if they want to assemble this coalition against the Xaryxians, they probably need to talk to this guy, Vokath, and he's a Jabba the Hutt type character. He's a merchant, Mercane, but he's got this big... He's not Jabba the Hutt. He's not evil, but he's a, you know, he's just sort of like a neutral merchant, has this big floating citadel palace place, and there's also some, there's an arena in there. This chapter was real all over the place for me.
Yeah, there's arena that then shifts after an attack by the Astral Elves into forming the Rebel Alliance that the players already thought existed, but in fact does not. I love a good arena battle. I'm not sure if this has to be in the same Doom Space system. I feel like you could put this almost anywhere. Yeah, that the players should just hear some rumors. Actually, maybe separate the two. The arena, like Vokath, could be a thing, you know, play a person that has something the players want, right? Forming the alliance doesn't have to happen at Vokath's arena.
I guess what's weird about this is, again, an arena battle, that's a classic. Again, we're talking classic pulp adventure trope. Yeah. I like it, but it kind of comes at the wrong place. Clearly, if they're going to do this, if they need to get an audience with Vokath, but he only will meet with people who win his arena battles, that's great. That's a classic, you know, maybe a little boring, but it's a good trope. They fight some arena battles, but it should come at the beginning rather than they go to Vokath's place and then he's like, you got to fight in the arena for me. Like, that's just much less dramatic this way. I think it's much more interesting. They're somewhere in Doom Space, somewhere neutral, and there's arena battles that happen there. And if you win, then you can meet with Vokath and ask his favor. That seems like a lot more straightforward. I think I'd also would like this a lot more if there hadn't been a bunch of annoying encounters that don't have anything to do with the main adventure. This would be a lot more interesting if it had not come where it did.
Yeah, I mean, honestly, Vokath could be the one that has the weapon, right? Mm-hmm. That has the princess, right? And when the princess is introduced, she sort of tells the players, yes, I am, you know, my brother has usurped my place on the throne. I am willing to stop the Astral Elves, you know, rampage of the world and save your world if you help me out. And I think Vokath would be willing to, like, trade her for the player's favor or, you know, arena battle fights or whatever. Like, that Vokath seems an alternate place to put Princess Zadali. I also, it's like the players fight an arena battle and then again cliffhanger and then Prince Zelith shows up and basically there's not a lot the players can do as written to prevent him from taking his sister back. But like, and you know, the adventure he's using mislead, so the players can't actually kill him. It's definitely a Flash Gordon feel to have the villain show up and not, you know, not execute the players when they have the chance. I'm fine with this, but I would just, this encounter can happen at any time. So I would save this as like an event encounter you can deploy when it's logical and when the action is slowing.
Yeah, so this whole chapter was weird. Zealous shows up when the players are meeting or meet with Vokath, and they've got his sister, and he wants her back. And as written, and again, you are then once again forced into a dialogue with yourself where Zadali and Zelith are arguing about the future of the Xaryxian Empire. And if, as written, you know, you're supposed to, Zadali is supposed to eventually go with Zelith, because if she doesn't, he bombards like all the ships on the dock, rounds up and executes a bunch of people. And, you know, the adventure can continue, but it definitely feels like you fucked up and there's not much you can do about it. And this just feels very, yeah, again, it is a bit Flash Gordon-y, a little Star Wars-y, but it just, this can come anywhere and it coming here, it's just, yeah, I don't know. It's
the basically there's also
really
a
have
mini
a choice, you know. Yeah. It's just
there's,
yeah,
no,
it's
choice
very...
And yeah, it's often like the players are like, oh man, we got to do this and do this thing, and as written the plot just kind of hands you the next the yeah. next thing, right? So it's very little, again, from playing a role-playing game, things are better when they feel like they have been earned by the player characters. Oh, mm-hmm. We accomplished finding the next step, and it's very much the next step just kind of arrives at your doorstep. The players are passengers on this wild ride. You get a two-page kind of mini game of building the Alliance, and I think if we rearrange things, building the Alliance could be like two or three chapters in and of itself. Of instead of all the species being from one system, they're from different systems. And if you want a Spelljammer campaign where the players are like exploring strange worlds, they could head to three or four systems ravaged by the Xaryxian Empire and negotiate weird threats. Like, that would be cool.
Well, and this is, again, this is where I would depart entirely, because this is the most interesting part. I love assembling a coalition, but there's five barely sketched out, purely, like, they're all one species.
Planet of Hats, you know?
Planet of Hats stuff, right? And factions are the most interesting part of Spelljammer. These could be five of any number of cool Spelljammer factions that in and of themselves have an extended quest chain. And I don't like want to suggest sending your players on a bunch of like, you know, fetch quests, but this is interesting. You have to go to another system. You have to meet with, gain the trust of, help a faction, a species, or whatever. Like, this is a whole interesting campaign in and of itself. And the fact that this is just a two-page minigame drives me batty. I would cut half of everything else and make this so much more important.
Yeah. What, Rob, can you think of a faction that, let's say, lives on the Astral Sea and might be natural rivals for the Astral Elves in the Xaryxian Empire that also has one of the coolest locations in all of D&D? They start with a G and end with a Yankee. You know,
this is exactly right.
And let the players go negotiate with the, you know, obviously kind of evil, but sort of sympathetic Githyanki and meet with their immortal Lich Queen on their city floating on a body of a dead god.
Yes.
And if they
have
succeed,
their own reasons to not want an astral elf planet blowing up empire to come and rule realm space. Like, it's just,
you know, who else might, like, everyone might want to do this. So maybe you could have the players negotiate with the Mind Flayers. Now the Githyanki don't like them.
Right?
The Beholders, like, might even join them, you know?
That would be dangerous and interesting. Like, you'd have to negotiate with some monstrous races.
That would like be great. I would love to, you know, that's one where, like, the players are most likely to fail, but that would be fun. Like, let's go talk to the Beholders, and they're like, okay, they're all in, you know, insane xenophobic.
Right. This is probably not
aberrations
to work, but
that
yeah,
one didn't work.
But it would be much more interesting if you were trying to get the Githyanki and the Illithids, right, to help you stop the Xaryxian Empire. And that would be a much more interesting and challenging campaign, right?
Deploy the information the players have figured out earlier. Maybe they did a spy mission using their Star Moth, or they just surveyed Xaryxis space. Okay, they know the Astral Elves have a fleet of 30 ships. If they want to take it out, they're going to need a bigger fleet or somewhere close. Or maybe Princess Zadala can, you know, a princess has the plans for the evil empire. So she can give them that information or something like that. Like, let the players discover it. Let them, you know, want to build this faction themselves, and let it play out of like, oh, hey, the players want to assemble an elite strike team of five ships because that's all they can get. No, the players want to assemble a giant fleet. Let them do that, right? There's just so much you could do here. It just doesn't work for a written adventure in the way that WotC tends to write their adventures.
Yeah. And you could create your own factions. You could bring in some old ones from Spelljammer of old, you know.
If your players are from Toril, have them go back and get the Harpers on board,
right?
You know,
the Green Concern, even the Flesh Dealers, you know, bring in some, again, there's a lot of like really like neutral and complicated factions, but that are powerful. That would be,
again, if the players start on Toril, well, you know, this is the, you know, what about Superman problem, you know, it describes these crystal vines growing all over the planet.
Right. Like, it's going to destroy, like, Toril. Like, what is
everyone would be, you know, yeah, you know, Black Staff, the Red Wizards of Thay, you know, everyone is would be concerned about this. And the players should be able to rally these factions. And honestly, if you have a group of players that are really invested in the lore of the Forgotten Realms, this could be a great chance for, okay, we're going to assemble our alliance from Toril. And awesome, we get to go to Waterdeep, and we get to go to Thay, and we get to go to Chult. And all right, we're going to help, you know, put a elite team of Toril Avengers
and heroes
together.
And ships together. This is cool. This is one of my favorite tropes. I love to do this in games of all sorts. I love putting together a fleet of disparate heroes to you know, make one final stand against a great evil. So the book assumes that you put together the coalition and you've got all these guys and all their ships, which is pretty cool. You know how many ships you have in your ragtag assembly.
Right.
And then, sorry, I
just thought of one more thing. So for the final, you know, Death Star run, there's basically like five ways you should let your players approach this. Assemble a giant fleet, assemble a strike team of small ships, assemble an elite stealth team of just their one ship that's going to somehow sneak in, and let any of those be a valid way to attack, right? And if it fails, they can try a different one. Or even a diplomatic way where they try and start a civil war.
Exactly.
Why wouldn't that work?
Have an infiltration team. I mean, you know, let them choose their approach. Maybe they want to have the main fleet attack, but a smaller infiltration unit of starfighters make an attack on a low, undefended trench. Anyway, I just like...
Look at the size of that thing.
However you want to do it, let your players choose, right? Don't say you have to assemble this gigantic fleet and then attack in force.
Okay, final chapters. We've got the Xaryxis space and the Temple of Light. The Imperial Citadel is a giant butterfly in space. It's super cool.
Sorry.
We're not given a chance to like explore, interact with it. I would add some stuff
here. There's another random encounter, and this really is starting to like annoy me immensely at this point. But they run into a Githyanki knight riding a red dragon, and he's just there to say, "Hello, here's a magic item. Go kick Xaryxian ass." I mean, Matt just mentioned that this would be a perfect faction who would want to participate in fighting the Xaryxian Empire, but you just sort of like run into one and he's like, "Good job, kids," and off he goes. I just like, why even put this in here? It annoys me immensely. Anyway,
he's like, "Have you seen any mind flayers?" He has a NPC ass dialogue from Baldur's Gate. Whenever you click
mind flayer, it's oblivion dialogue. He's
it's,
"Hail, citizen, have you seen any mind flayers?
Check out my silver sword." What else do we know about Githyanki?
My dragon and I are hunting mind flayers. Have you seen any? Anyway, I don't even know what this is about. I'm annoyed.
I love the final attack. There's a fleet, and then there's the surprise encounter of an army of solar dragons, regardless of what the players find out, unless they're really, really good, that's one I would keep in your back pocket for the twist, right? No plan, survives contact with the enemy. And, you know, so if the players assemble a fleet that can easily take out the Imperial fleet, then pull the, "We made it interesting by solar dragons attack. The player characters have to take out the biggest one."
I like this. This is a really good complication. I can just imagine how exciting this would be. There's a big space battle, and then suddenly they think they're winning. Here comes seven solar dragons off the starboard bow. Good luck.
But okay, then here's the problem is the final encounter assumes that the player's fleet is defeated, right? And then it also assumes that the players surrender to the Astral Elves. Now, this is very Buck Rogers, right? This always happens in Flash Gordon. The players attack Ming the Merciless, and they always lose, and then, you know, Ming brings them right to the place they need to destroy or whatever, and they break free of their bonds and press the big red button. That's fine, but that play style doesn't work with the Dungeons & Dragons system. It works with adventure, exclamation point, a great pulp system where these types of, you can just do these things. You say, players, you get captured. Everyone gets a Benny and a reroll, but yeah, because that's what's happened to the plot. It's not part of D&D's DNA. It sucks. I don't like it. It's also, it gives the players no agency. What if they assembled the best fleet of all
what if
time?
What if they're really
good? It doesn't
good?
Matter.
What if their fleet wins? Like, you know.
Anyway. Okay, so.
Seems kind of dumb also that, like, no matter what, they can't win. Like, no matter how good and how prepared they are, like, they assembled a bunch of idiots that were never going to defeat 30 Star Moths and 7 Solar Dragons. I'm just, it rubs me the wrong way, Matt.
So, this is where you also need some major reworking. So, I like the idea of if the players lose, sure, they're captured and these arrogant, immortal, near-immortal elves take them to their citadel, right? And so the campaign can continue. That's fine. One of the things this campaign, in the way it's written, is no matter what the players succeed or fail at, the same thing kind of happens, right? Yeah. With various, you know, if you succeed, it's usually better for you, but not always. Sometimes if you fail, something better happens. Again, you're on a roller coaster. The things you do don't really matter. The crowning moment is the players are kind of presented at the coronation of the bad elf, and then the good elf asks them to kind of fight for them. I would just say that, like, the players are, you know, attacking the citadel and they're trying to prevent the coronation, and eventually they either defeat the fleet and they can make the elves surrender. There's a negotiation. They have a chance to put, you know, after they defeated the fleet, maybe they have the chance to put a friendly emperor on the throne. There's still a ton of astral elves out there. The players might be thinking, okay, yeah, we can't just wipe out all of these imperialists. We still have to deal with all the ones on the astral plane. Let's put a good emperor in charge. The players have a fight.
Yeah, so this
with
is
a Zodar.
This is clever-ish. You know, they get taken to the center, and then there's a challenge for the throne between Zadali and Zeleth, right? And they're chosen as Zadali's champions, right? Trial by combat, classic way to you know, give your characters a chance. So they have to fight a
if
Zodar.
If your party has an elf, a way to redo this, if they have the magic MacGuffin ring, that elf could challenge for the right for the imperial throne. I would love for the astral elves to be ruled by, you know, Cletus, the slack-jawed yokel wood elf, like, you know, who's actually, yeah, turns out is the real heir of the, you know, pull your players and let one of your players become emperor of the astral elves for kicks, you know.
They fight the Zodar, which is one of the cooler monsters from the new, from the Spelljammer.
The Zodar, when it's defeated, gives the players a wish to let them complete the campaign. You know, maybe the players should have just got a wish spell all along.
This is the Deus Ex Machina-est Deus Ex Machina I have ever encountered. I have reread this 2 or 3 times, and I'm just not, like, really clear on how this is supposed to work. So they defeat the Zodar. The Zodar gives them a wish. The turns out the Ring of Shooting Stars, which both the princelings have, if you throw it into the star,
Mount
it will
Doom.
Destroy Xaryxia and save their world. So Matt, I'm sorry if I'm confused.
No, it's okay. I'm confused too.
They haven't defeated the Xaryxian Empire. Why would the Xaryxian Empire let them take this ring and destroy the star? Because that's what's supposed to happen next, according to the adventure.
Right. It would seem like basically all of those elves in this giant city, some of which are very powerful priests and spellcasters, just kind of stand aside and let the players do it because they're in charge now.
Yeah.
But so I guess you have to play the elves as, like, they are adherents to authority. They are all lawful, except for the leaders, who are chaotic, as described in the thing. And they will all just obey the commands. Like, you know, the players can talk to the priests and they're like, hey, your citadel that's shaped like a ship, couldn't you, like, mount a spell helm on it and move it to the astral sea? And they're like, yeah, we could do that. And you're like, oh, God, God damn it. Right. Again, we could move it to the astral sea where everyone is immortal. Why isn't it there in the first place? You have to here's the answer, Rob. The answer is Flash Gordon. The answer is Ming the Merciless. Like, his plans don't make sense. They're just evil, right?
Right.
The Cobra
right.
Commander. I'm right. going to blow up the ocean, right?
Right.
Like, why would you right. want to do that? It doesn't matter, right? And the same is true with the twist. If the players win and they're siding with the sister twin empress, Zedali, she betrays them. Nothing yeah. in this adventure would hint that she's that evil other than she's an arrogant elf. And there's really yeah. no reason for her to not follow through on the promise, but she operates under Ming the Merciless Flash Gordon logic, which is, you know, sudden but not inevitable betrayals are cool.
Yeah. So if I were going to keep this part, I wouldn't. But I think one thing that might make sense is if one of the... Again, because defeating the Zodar and this wish kind of complicates the trial by combat. So maybe there's a civil war, right? Neither sibling is willing to accept this outcome, and the Xaryxian Citadel is divided by loyalty, and in the chaos, the players can escape. That is, I think, something that might make sense. But as written, this is just absolute nonsense. It feels very like... we ran out of time on the page, and so...
I'm okay with throw the MacGuffin into the star is the answer, and but the players, again, have no opportunity to ever find out this information. They only find it out one story beat before they have to do it, right? Which is how the entire adventure works, right? Which is just very frustrating to me. And different organization of this campaign where the players can find out, oh... we need a royal ring and we need to throw it in as the star, which a great time to deploy that would be after the players win their battle against the Xaryxian Empire, or even after they lose and they can mount a second this time. Okay, we tried blunt force. We lost. We didn't know they had all those solar dragons. This time we need to, you know, go down to the planet and disable the shield generator and then throw the mm-hmm. ring into the sun. I like the ending requires... someone, the only way to get into the sun close enough to drop the ring in is to be destroyed by the sun. Yep. So one of the player's characters has to make a sacrifice.
Or,
of course,
convince
a goth pirate.
Yes.
I just want to die. It's fine. No, it's yeah. not.
No.
Someone has to make a sacrifice.
I think a character has to, I think the only way to make this satisfying is somebody's character has to volunteer. That's a dramatic
and that's a very epic. Yeah, and if you know the campaign's ending, you know you're going to have, at least at my table, someone who's like, either I wanted to roll up a new character anyway, or like, this would be such a cool end to my character. Yes. Everyone's going to remember this forever. Yes. Okay, and then we're at the end of the campaign. There's not a lot about further adventures. It just says you can go back to Brawl.
Very weak. Yeah, there's almost nothing. There's something in Doom Space you can explore, or you can go back to Rock of Brawl and... maybe someone has a quest for you. I think there's a lot more that you could seed, but as written, kind of flat, kind of disappointing.
Yeah. I think like there's a lot of elements here that are really cool. I yep. do like the idea of the evil elf empire.
Yes,
and
I think that's
yes,
very cool.
Yes, it's just a Death Star. Whatever. The Death Star's a cool idea.
The
I love
seeds
it.
Or whatever. Yeah. I think that's cool enough. I think that's a great, like, again, I would just change it so that they have a deep and abiding, you know, galactic religion, which demands that their star burn forever. And
right. It's so their homeworld. They can't give it up. Most astral elves live on the astral sea, but their homeworld is important. It doesn't mention this, but astral elves do need a place for their children to grow. Mm. And maybe this is that place. If you want to give them a more sympathetic angle. Right. And their religion demands that every astral elf grow up on one of Xaryxis's planets. There is a ton of cool NPCs here. There's actually a couple pretty great encounters.
I love Flapjack. I love Warwick Blastemoff. Oh, yeah. Honestly, I like all of them. They all have something.
Yeah, I love the stupid bird wizard's astrotographer that like she's great. There is enough here that is worth saving. However, for me, and I know this is not the case for everyone, I just can't deal with making my players do the next thing. They don't, my players don't like it, and I don't find it satisfying as a dungeon master. Yes, it solves the problem of there's never a debate of what do we want to do next. But for me, that's not a problem. That's the thing I like about the game. So for me, this is a fundamentally flawed campaign. However, as a conclusion, we've been going for a long time, Rob. Just what are some of our final thoughts about restructuring the campaign? If people find this very interesting, I might feel inspired to write some of these up. Let me know. Send me an email at dmofnone@gmail.com if that's something that would interest you. But let's just rapid fire anything we missed, any other final reworks we would do.
Yeah, so I would keep all of the elements and rearrange them. I think we've already discussed it kind of at length, but I love assembling the factions. I love, you know, let your players find out on their own. Like Matt said, if they want to go directly to Xaryxian space and get their asses kicked, let them do that.
Let them.
But then let them know, have them go immediately to the Rock of Brawl, have them learn from Luigi or anyone else that there's all these people who have fought the Xaryxians. There's all these factions that might be able to help take them on, and if they want to save either their world or the world that they were on, or just stop the Xaryxians in general, they're going to need to work with these people. And then set up kind of, I would just set up, again, this is how I would structure it in my mind, but like three or four, maybe more than that, mini adventures, right, where they have to go, and then there's more for them to do once they speak to the Githyanki, more of them to go and try to convince the Illithids, more to go meet all of these NPCs, and then they can make their own decision about how to take on the Xaryxian Empire. I'm ambivalent on whether or not I would keep the Ring of Shooting Stars. That is very, like, Star Wars-y, very Flash Gordon to have them have to throw a magical artifact into the sun, but I can take it or leave it. I would have to, obviously, I would keep nothing about the final chapter because that was the most frustrating and, to me, incomplete part. But the rest of it I love, and I love taking on an evil empire. I love a new threat coming out of nowhere. All of the pieces are good. The way they're put together is very frustrating.
Yeah, I'm thinking back about it. Like, here is exactly what I would use this book for. If you want to run the basic idea of evil empire must stop, that is all you need from this book. The book is then useful for you for NPCs and a couple interesting locations. Like, the random Illithid derelict ship, the arena, a couple of the NPCs, right?
The art of Flapjack, the flump with a hat.
Yes, the flump with a hat. The approach of let the players decide how to assemble their coalition. It could be back in Toril. It could be across the wild space. Has to be left up for them. So the way you redo this adventure is chapter one, with the changes we suggested, chapter two is expanded to at least a couple sessions on Brawl, and the players get their own ship. The middle section, instead of being endless NPC, sends you to the next NPC, is an open-ended exploration of the Spelljammer universe. The players, like Rob said, can get their asses kicked at the Xaryxian Empire, or maybe even not. Maybe they get to the Citadel and they can find out a bunch of things, learn a bunch of clues. And then it's up to them to decide how to assemble something that can take them down, right? Yep. And then somewhere in there, you know, you give them the clue that there is a weapon. The weapon is the princess. That's a great twist. Can give them more information.
I would keep that for sure. Yeah.
The final chapter, like, let them succeed. And then after they've conquered the Xaryxians, they go down there and, you know, sure, this asshole prince is still alive. He challenges them for right to rule. The players can just kill them or they can accept their challenge. And that would make them the legitimate rulers, or make, you know, Princess Sindali the legitimate ruler. And then they, of course, can discover from him how to destroy the sun.
This would also be a pretty classic twist, but like maybe there's a way to save the star that doesn't involve, you know, sucking other planets dry, right? Maybe there's a ritual they can do, or another distant system that they have to travel to and acquire another magical MacGuffin, you know?
I would say I like the moral conundrum of this star is dying and this is the only way to save it. And sure, then the alternate way is like we have to convince the Xaryxians to move their citadel into the astral plane, and that
or to find a new system. I mean, that would be a good
Guess what? Astral elves are going to have to foster their children with normal elves all over the multiverse. And that means that some of them won't come back, but that's fine.
Yeah. I mean, maybe that's a continuing adventure, is shepherding this citadel through space, like
Battlestar Galactica.
Battlestar Galactica style, exactly.
I would say another fun, I mean, the continuing adventures, this one, I think I would be done with this adventure after beating this, especially because the one thing you don't get to do in the adventures written is explore on your own. But if you take our advice, there's plenty of chance for just exploration and random encounters and weird systems as the players search for allies and weapons. If they defeat the Xaryxian Empire and they want to continue on, I think there's some interesting planar travel that they could go on. You could introduce the one coalition partner that they didn't get on their side as the next threat, be it the Beholders, the Githyanki, or the Mind Flayers. The Mind Flayers are the quintessential Spelljammer villains. Or if you have Vokoth as the as like a weird NPC power broker who is instead of kind of off on his own linked to the other Mercanes who can all talk to each other, maybe the whole thing was orchestrated by the Mercanes. The Mercanes took out the Astral Elves using the player characters, and now they have a plan to do something terrible. They're selling off Astral Space to the god Kord, who's going to turn it into a gymnasium.
Ooh, that would be good. Yeah, I mean, sorry, and I didn't explicitly say this, but like the key thing that I would change is that I would give the players a ship.
Either you got to give them a ship in chapter immediately. Two.
Either they are attacked and win a battle and take over a ship, or they can buy one, or they find one. But like,
and then the great thing is every time you have an encounter after that, the players decide, do we like this ship more than our ship? And they can move their stuff to a new ship. And then, okay, we started with a traveler. Now we have a turtle ship. Okay, we went to Hammerhead. Okay.
And yes, this is going to be more work for you as a DM, but I think that this adventure as written is very unsatisfying, and you're going to spend a lot of time trying to convince your players not to take over someone's ship instead of, you know, whatever they're supposed to be doing. So just save yourself the time and effort and let them have a ship.
Okay, I'm kind of feeling like running this adventure now that we've talked through some of the ways it can be fixed. I don't know.
I really want to run something in Spelljammer, and I want to use pieces of this maybe, but yeah, it needs some work.
Needs some work. All right, Rob, hopefully everyone listening, you got some good ideas for fixing this adventure. The art here is great. The art of Spelljammer Academy, which again, I would not recommend for just the way it's set up, is also really good. No one's free, so steal some extra NPC portraits and maps from there.
If you have your own thoughts or you have other questions, definitely let us know. Email us at dmofnone@gmail.com. Add us on Twitter @dmofnone. Follow us on Patreon, patreon.com/dungeonmasterofnone.
Keep sailing the stars, everyone.
Absolutely. Thank you for listening. Stay healthy, stay safe, and keep rolling them dice.